Pastor Sherry has read this morning already. If we could have the PowerPoint up, please. Has read Romans 8, and there has been a, if we can go back to the first slide, please. Thank you. Has been going through a series of sessions of Bible-based, Jesus-focused, and Holy Spirit-led. As you see, this picture is probably a very familiar sight. If in your hometown, country, you walk around and you will see sights like this. So whether someone is building a small house or even in a garage, or you get into the city and you're building a bigger building, this is something that every building has. Anything that you want to last for a longer period of time. Now what happens is when the building is finished, you don't see this. You only see this during construction. After that, it's covered up. It is buried, and the foundations are hidden. These series, Bible-based, Jesus-focused, Holy Spirit-led, are foundations. They are fundamental to who we are in Christ Jesus. There is no nothing that will remove this once the building is up. We rest on this. And as it is in our Christian faith, we have a base, and from that base we grow. So we call it securing our foundations. The next slide, whether it's in a city, bigger building, affirming the fundamentals, the same concept. You want to make sure everything is working. When someone, as I mentioned last time when I was here talking about Jesus focused on the same concept, when you come into someone's home, you don't ask how many bags of cement they put into their foundation. You don't ask how much rebar went into the foundations. You don't have to ask, because if the contractor cheated and did not put enough in, you will see the cracks on the wall. You will have the doors that don't close, or windows that don't quite close. And then you can spend all the money you want trying to fix the cracked wall, but it'll keep cracking every year. Foundations are absolutely crucial. You don't see them, but they're there. Make sure they're right. So you remember, if next slide is, as we think back to our childhood days, those of you that went to Sunday school, the song, Read Your Bible, Pray Every Day. Do you remember that one? There's a few people remember. How many remember that? Okay, there we go. Truth, plain truth. Read your Bible, pray every day, if you want to grow in Christ. And I trust as we grow in Christ that we have the opportunity to sit back on occasion, such as we do at New Year's, and we look back and to see the milestones that God has brought us through, and to see, to test the growth in Christ Jesus. So today I want to talk about Holy Spirit-led, and the text has been read in Romans chapter 8. If you have your Bibles, you can turn to this, because we're going to be looking through various sections of this, but we're going to look first of all at this text in Romans 8, verse 14. For all who are led by the Spirit of God are children of God. All who are led by the Spirit of God are children of God. Father, we come to you this morning, thankfulness on our hearts that you have adopted us, you've taken us into your family, we've been born again. Thank you for new life. And so, Lord, we commit ourselves to you. We commit ourselves to the leading of your Holy Spirit. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. I want to take a look for a few minutes at the Holy Spirit, starting with the Old Testament. The Trinity, God the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, three in one, three persons. And last Friday, Pastor Sherry spoke on that. We were over in Mishref. It's the beauty about the YouTube. I could catch the sermon at least the gist of it. So Pastor Sherry last week talked about the triune God, three parts and of one, and it's so difficult to use human terms to express divinity. In fact, every analogy that we use trying to explain the Trinity, it falls short. Every analogy, every terminology we have. How do we as human mortals explain three persons yet one? Very difficult. So we look at it from different angles and use various analogies to come up. But let's look today specifically at the Holy Spirit and who is the Holy Spirit, and starting with the Old Testament. So it starts right at the beginning in Genesis chapter 1 and verse 2. And this is what it says. The earth was formless and empty, and darkness covered the deep waters, and the Spirit of God was hovering over. And some other translations said moving over or brooding over the surface of the waters. And so in the midst of this emptiness or voidness, what it seems to be like is that we see already we're just into the second verse of the Bible, and we are already introduced to the third person of the Trinity. And here is the Holy Spirit. His mandate, his job, is to hover over the earth. That same word is used only two times in the Old Testament. The next time it's used, have the next slide, please, in Deuteronomy 32, verse 11, like an eagle that stirs up its nest, that hovers over its young, he, that is God, spread his wings and caught them, the Israelites, in the desert, and he carried them on his pinions. And you can see that if you watch documentaries from National Geographic and other places, how they show how the eagle hovers over and protects, and when it takes its little ones and is trying to teach them how to fly, a good little kick out of the nest. And when an eagle has a nest, it's not sitting just 5 feet above the ground. We know where eagles put their nests. They are way up there. And a drop from an eagle's nest is very, very far. So that eaglet has a long premium flight. Lots of time for the mother eagle to hover over it to make sure that it learns how to fly. The Holy Spirit hovers over us. The Holy Spirit has been given to us to make sure that we live like sons and daughters in the kingdom of God. Mistakes are made. The Holy Spirit picks us up, brings us back, says, try it again. It's the job of the Holy Spirit. Has been since the beginning. Next slide. The Spirit of God in general in the Old Testament basically refers to is manifest through the prophets. And you will read this many times where it says that the Spirit came upon a prophet for a specific duty or task, and that he would speak the oracles of God, and the action would be fulfilled many times by signs and wonders. And that was the working of the Holy Spirit. And so already in the Old Testament, this is not exclusive to the New Testament, this is already in the Old Testament, that signs and wonders happened for the very purpose of validating the spoken word of God. As it was in the Old Testament, so it is in the New. You can take almost all the miracles in the Old Testament where the Holy Spirit would rest on someone for a specific time and duty, miracles would happen. The same type of miracle would happen in the New Testament. And we'll talk about the difference between the Old and the New in just a minute. But here it is in the Old Testament. And we see this and we know this. Just read through the books of Samuel and Kings and Chronicles, and you will see this manifested over and over. Next slide, please. Shows us the Holy Spirit. Now here, notice, not just talking about the Spirit of God, but now the Holy Spirit. The first time in the Old Testament where Holy and Spirit come together is in Psalm 51. Up until then, it's the Spirit of God, the Spirit of God, Spirit of God. Now it's the Holy Spirit. And notice the context in which it first comes up. Psalm 51, I think you know this one. The context of 51, this is David's prayer, King David's prayer, after he committed the sins of adultery and of murder, and he recognizes at this time the holiness of God, and the one plea that he has, and it comes out in his prayer here in Psalm 51, he cries out and he says, Lord, do not take your Holy Spirit from me. Very interesting that this is the first time that Holy and Spirit come together. We know in the New Testament that is assumed quite a bit. There's only a few times that it happens. It also happens in Isaiah 63. This is the second and third time that Holy and Spirit come together in the Old Testament, but they rebelled against him and grieved his Holy Spirit. This is the prophet Isaiah here talking about the time when the nation of Israel was doing its wandering out of Egypt, having left the country of bondage where they were slaves and heading towards their promised land, but they were not yet in the promised land and they were in this wilderness time. And this one here continues with Isaiah. So he became their enemy, that is, God. He fought against them. And then they remembered those days of old when Moses led his people out of Egypt. They cried out, where is the one who brought Israel through the sea with Moses as their shepherd? Where is the one who sent his Holy Spirit to be among his people? And there is a recognition by the prophet Isaiah that it was, in fact, the Holy Spirit that was guiding them through the wilderness. The cloud by day, the pillar of fire by night. The Holy Spirit guiding his people even through that time. Next slide. Holy Spirit in New Testament. Let's take a look at this for just a few minutes. And what we've got is by the time we have the opening of the New Testament, you've got this quiet period of about 400 years where the activity of the Holy Spirit had been very minimalized, not because the Holy Spirit was absent, but because the people were not receptive to the Holy Spirit. And so with the passing of the last prophets some 400 years ago, there's a quietness that's there. And in particular in Luke, but Matthew picks it up as well, at the birth of Jesus, starting even at the announcement, you find all of a sudden all this activity of the Holy Spirit, angels coming and ministering and prophecies coming again. And in fact, here we have it identified very clearly that Mary is conceived by the Holy Spirit, thus introducing to us the second Adam. Jesus will now be born as a man, God coming down. And we're going through this on Sunday nights in the Gospel of John, through our Sunday services, that it is the Holy Spirit that is working through the lives of people, the third person of the Trinity. And here in Matthew, it is the second Adam who is sinless, conceived by the Holy Spirit, and for your redemption and for mine. The Holy Spirit in the New Testament continues, just for example, in Matthew 3, verses 11, where John the Baptist says, I baptize you with water for repentance, but after me comes one who is more powerful than I, whose sandals I am not worthy to carry. He will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and fire. I'm looking forward to getting to this into John. We'll probably get into it in the next few weeks about John the Baptist's function and why he came and the significance and the difference between water baptism and baptism in the Holy Spirit. And that's why the writer of Hebrews talks about baptisms, plural. He doesn't talk about baptism, but baptisms, plural. And so I want to encourage you, those of you who have not yet been baptized in the Holy Spirit, to look at the scripture and ask God, fill me, baptize me with your Holy Spirit. This is what John said. He came. We are, as a church, as a congregation, we're looking at the foundations. We're looking at fundamentals. All right. We're looking at stuff that holds the building together. Bible-based, Jesus-focused, Holy Spirit-led. Okay. Absolutely crucial. We don't want cracks in our walls. We don't want things coming out of our mouth that represent the cracks in the walls or doors that don't close because the wall is shifting. We want to be Christians who are solid, straight, and accurate. And that comes by reading our Bible, by being Jesus-focused, and by being led by the Holy Spirit. And so John says there's coming one. John says, I baptize you with water, and I trust most of you this morning have been baptized in water. And then the baptism of the Holy Spirit. And he says he will do it with fire, and it's available. It came on the day of Pentecost, and for 2,000 years that has been coming on and on. We are to be a people led by the Holy Spirit. In order to be led by the Holy Spirit, we have to follow the Holy Spirit. A little hard to be led by the Spirit if we're not following the Spirit. So let's be very careful what the Scripture says here on this. Now, I could talk a whole lot more about Matthew and the Holy Spirit, but let me just move on here for a minute about John, the Holy Spirit in John. Is that in John, he identifies the Holy Spirit as advocate, as counselor, and so forth. And in particular, in John chapter 16, verse 13, he says, when the Spirit of truth comes, he will guide you into all truth. And that's another reason it's so very, very important to be led by the Holy Spirit, because the Holy Spirit guides us into truth. If we want truth, be led by the Holy Spirit. Be Bible-based and Jesus-focused. Well, let's move on to Holy Spirit in the Bible as a whole. The combination of Holy and Spirit is about 100 times in the Bible, 40 of them occur in the book of Acts. You want an exciting, action-packed book? It's Acts. In fact, some historians have labeled the book of Acts as the Acts of the Holy Spirit. Our different, maybe your whatever your home language is and your whatever translations you have, you probably have had different titles to the book of Acts. And this is probably one of the most accurate titles that can be ascribed to it, because the book of Acts is loaded with the Acts of the Holy Spirit and what happens to people who are in fact led by the Holy Spirit. Well, let's move on to Paul's writings, the Spirit in Paul, because what happens here is we have this, as one of the slides showed earlier, we've got this concept of progressive revelation, in that we don't necessarily always understand everything at one time. For example, in Genesis 1 verse 2, it talks about the Spirit of God. And it's not until later that we understand that it is the Holy Spirit. As it is with Scripture, we talk about the Bible, and I know sometimes some will make a large to-do about identifying it, first of all, as the Holy Bible. Well, if you're born and raised in the church, that's the assumption we come to it with. It is holy. Our God is holy. So therefore, what He spoke is holy. What He has written is holy. His Spirit is holy. His Son is holy. And guess what? You and I are holy. Why? Because we are children of God. Now it's our duty to live up to that. And His Holy Spirit helps us to reach a state of contentment in the body of Christ. And where things are wrong, He will help us, because His Holy Spirit hovers over us to make sure we rise to His Spirit and live with Him. Well, back to Paul's writing. So we're talking about progressive revelation, and I'm coming close to my text. Assumption. God's Spirit is holy, and when we get to Romans 8, verses 1 to 16, what we'll find here is that the word Spirit occurs 16 times in these 16 verses. If you want to know what's important to a writer, just simply do a word count. What word keeps coming up over and over? And so you can't help but read Romans 8 and come to the conclusion that it's the Spirit of God that's the driving message of this particular passage. So I want to take a few minutes, you've got your Bibles to Romans 8, take a few minutes and go through some verses here as we move towards the communion service this morning. Verse 1, there is therefore now no condemnation to them which are in Christ Jesus. Now if your Bible stops there, please take a look at the footnote in the bottom. And if your Bible does not have a footnote at this time, please, I ask you, get a different Bible. Okay? The English translations we have, or the various other language translations that we have, they are based on various Greek texts. And there's several Greek texts actually have a continuation on this verse, and I trust your translation identifies the ongoing part of verse 1. It goes on to say, who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit. See, people often say, oh, there's no condemnation. That's half the truth. The other half is for those who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit. Now, in case you say, well, that's not in that particular Greek translation, well, but it repeats again a few verses later. It is scriptural, it is true. Let's go on to verse 2. And because you belong to him, the power of the life-giving Spirit has freed you from the power of sin that leads to death. Why is this so important? It's because we have to come to grips with the reality of the power of sin. When Adam and Eve sinned, you and I died. Dead. God said, the day you eat thereof, you will die. Adam and Eve ate of the fruit, they died. And from that day onward, all of humanity was under the power of sin. Sin was manifest by one word, and that is disobedience. To disobey God puts us at odds with God and puts us at enmity with God. We are hostile to God. We are enemies of God. We are the ones who are enemies to him. And Adam and Eve knew that, and God didn't hide himself from man. God still came down that evening and said, Adam, where are you? It was Adam and Eve that went and hid themselves. What sin does is sin separates. And you'll see, what does this mean? You've watched out from a pastoral perspective. Here's how it manifests itself sometimes. People are in the church and the things are going on well, but then they sin. And what's their first reaction? They stop coming to church. I know I'm speaking to the choir. You're here. I want to teach this to you again as a reminder for your friends. That should anyone ever say this, that's the worst thing that they could do. Can you imagine if Adam and Eve, after they ate of the fruit, hid themselves and kept hiding themselves? You see, God is searching. And God's holiness is not affected by what you do or what I do. Our holiness is, but not his. What you and I do does not affect his love. He doesn't love us any more or any less, whether we love him or don't love him. And therefore, it's important to make sure that we constantly read our Bibles every day, pray every day, and as often as possible, fellowship together with other believers. Very, very important. We don't hide ourselves. This is the power of sin. You see, and when people do stuff like that, when they do something wrong and then they pull themselves back from the community of believers, they're simply reinforcing the fact that sin dominates this world. We live in a fallen state. Paul writes it many times in his letters. He says sin is the dominant power of this local world. Now, when we come to Christ and we have our sins forgiven, we now are translated above that, and we sit with Christ Jesus in the heavenlies, and we are not subject to the power of sin. Amen? We're beyond that. We are led by the Spirit of God if we walk in fellowship with him, if we continue reading our Bibles, if we continue in prayer, if we continue in fellowship. All of this happens, right? And because you belong to him, the power of the life-giving Spirit has freed you from the power of sin. This is the manifestation. This is the application of understanding the Word of God, living by the Spirit of God. If we understand this, if we apply it, we will live as free people. We don't live dominated by the pressures of this world. We live on a different plane. It's like the person, you can see them, everyone's marching down in a nice row, and then another guy's got earplugs in and he's moving to a total different beat. And they say, that guy's walking to a different beat, a drum beat. We as Christians walk on this earth, not by the drum beat of sin or darkness, but we are tuned in to truth and to righteousness, and we walk according to truth and righteousness. Verse 3, please. The law of Moses was unable to save us because of weakness of our sinful nature, so God did what the law could not do. He sent his only son in a body like the bodies we sinners have. And in that body, God declared an end to sin's control over us by giving his son as a sacrifice for our sins. Verse 4, he did this so that the just requirement of the law would be fully satisfied for us. Notice here it is again. Who no longer follow our sinful nature, but instead follow the Spirit. You will notice that Paul in this chapter many times keeps using the word follow, 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 follow. You can only be led by the Spirit of God if we follow the Spirit of God. You ever try to, when you're driving and or you're with a friend and they say, okay, I'll drive ahead and you follow me. Okay? Now that works very nice on a country road in the evening when there's no other traffic. Try doing that during rush hour. And especially if the person ahead has a lead foot. A little difficult, huh? A little difficult. But we will get to our destination if we know how to follow. The key is to follow. Always. Those, verse 5, who are dominated by the sinful nature think about sinful things, but those who are controlled by this Holy Spirit think about things that please the Spirit. You see, what happens when you sit in your car and you're trying to follow your friend in the car ahead of you, there's lots of interferences, lots of obstacles that come in. But the beauty is, when we are children of God, led by the Spirit of God, it's not that the Holy Spirit is outside of us somewhere going ahead. The Holy Spirit is resident inside of us. And as we learn the truth that we are, first of all, spirit beings, we have a mind and we live in a body, if we understand that and live by that truth, we will begin to recognize that it is not our mind that leads us day by day, but rather our spirits. And we have to get into a place as Christians, as born-again believers, that we understand that we are first and foremost spirit beings and that it is our spirit that dictates our daily activities. And it comes with a course of time. This is nothing fancy or far-fetched. This is basic, basic biblical truth. Basic. This is absolutely foundational. That our spirits must be in tune with the Spirit of God because it's our spirits that dictate to our minds how they think. And that's why Paul says in Romans, transform, be renewed by the transforming of your mind. Transform it, renew it, establish it. How? Depends on what you want to lead the mind. You want the world and the advertising and the marketing and the peer pressure and the dictates of what the world tells us, or do you want the Holy Spirit to lead and guide? And so as we soak in the Word of God, this holy book, these scriptures, will help us formulate the mind of Christ within us. And Paul says that in Corinthians. He says sometimes, you know, in the past he quotes the Old Testament because in the Old Testament the Holy Spirit came upon people for a specific time and duty, and it seemed like almost as if when the job was done they left. But now in the New Testament, now that we are baptized in the Holy Spirit, we have the Holy Spirit living inside of us, we can operate with the fullness of Christ's mind. And he says, therefore God's ways once were higher, but now, he says, you have the mind of Christ. We have been elevated to be seated with Christ in the heavenlies. He has given us his mind. We think like him. We act like him and we talk like him. Very important for us to have. We need to move on here. So let verse 6, so letting your sinful nature control your mind leads to death. Don't let the world control your mind. But letting the Spirit control your mind leads to life and peace. What does life mean? I'm working that through in the Gospel of John. Life is not just the absence of death. Life is the fullness of life, understanding and celebrating all of that what God has given to us. We as Christians are and can be and should be the most liberated people on the face of the earth. Why? Because, again, body, soul, and spirit are all aligned, working together in this fullness. And that's why it's very important for us as Christians to be spirit-led, because God has placed you and I on this earth to be leaders, leading people to Jesus Christ, because Jesus is life, he is truth, he is light. Everything about humanity, Jesus came and represented. Everything. Fullness of life. And you and I have that opportunity to be examples to our neighbors, friends, people that we work with. Verse 7, for the sinful nature is always hostile to God. It never did obey God's laws, and it never will. And that's why those who are still under the control of their sinful nature can never please. Let's go on here. Verse 8. Can never please God. Verse 9. But you are not controlled by your sinful nature. You are controlled by the Spirit. Notice the word again. If you have the Spirit of God living in you. And remember that those who do not have the Spirit of Christ living in them do not belong to Him at all. Very important. Very important. If you're born again, you have the Spirit of God living inside of you. How do we know that? It is impossible to become a Christian without the working of the Holy Spirit. It doesn't happen. It can't happen. Because it's a spiritual event that takes place. As we believe in our hearts, think back to when we were saved, as we believe in our hearts that we were sinners, and we confess with our mouth that we were born in sin and that we sinned because we were sinners, and then we confess Jesus as the only Lord and Savior of our lives, and we believe it in our hearts and confess it with our mouth, that is the rebirth. And John makes a big deal about being born again. He says it in his first chapter, in the third chapter, and in different places. That's being born again. Being born again can only happen by the working of the Holy Spirit, which means that the Holy Spirit is inside of us. So then you might be asking then, well, what's this about the baptism of the Holy Spirit? What does that do? Well, parallel to water baptism, you get saved in Christ Jesus. You are born again. And that can only happen by the heart. And by confessing with our mouth. And then at a later stage, be it whether it's a half an hour later or whether it's 2 weeks later or 2 years later, but as a subsequent event, we get into the baptismal water. And by the way, today at 2:30, there's a baptismal out here today, baptizing three people. They will get into the water and we will baptize them, symbolizing what they have already done. Died to self, buried self, and come up in the newness of life. And so it is baptism in fire in the Holy Spirit. It is our opportunity to give up our own rights and yield 100% to the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit's inside of us, but do we give Him control? It's up to us. And one of the evidences, the initial evidence that is there, is that the most difficult member of the mouth or the body, this tongue, which sometimes wags too much and can get us into all kinds of trouble, okay, so easily. When we are yielded to the Holy Spirit and surrender ourselves, and in the same way in the Spirit get baptized, and we say, I yield my fullness of my Spirit to the Spirit of God, and He brings us up to the newness of life. A very evident evidence is that our tongue is now released and the Holy Spirit can take control of it, okay? And of course, we want to speak our Father's language in any case, correct? We want to commune directly. Our spirits want to commune with our Father. Spirit gives you life because you have been made right with God. Verse 11, the Spirit of God who raised Jesus from the dead lives in you. And just as God raised Christ Jesus from the dead, he will give life to your mortal bodies by the same Spirit living within you. This is powerful to understand that the living, holy God has given us his Spirit. Who are we? Who are we? Now, this is something already the Old Testament saints understood. Remember back to what David prayed in Psalm 51 after he sinned? Take not your Holy Spirit from me. Therefore, verse 12, therefore, dear brothers and sisters, you have no obligation to do what your sinful nature urges you to do. For if you live by its dictates, you will die. But if through the power of the Spirit you put to death the deeds of your sinful nature, you will live. And here's our text. For all who are led by the Spirit of God are children of God. Christianity is not an issue, and we know this, it's not an issue of coming to church or having church membership, or paying our tithes, or coming and singing songs. The essence of Christianity is right here in this verse. For all who are led by the Spirit of God are children of God. And he has created a family on this earth, a family of sons and daughters who walk like him, who talk like him, who live like him, and who are ambassadors in this dark, evil world to shine the light of his glory, to shine the glory of Jesus as Jesus walked on this face of this earth and shone the glory of his Father. You and I have that same opportunity to shine the light of Jesus. Verse 15, so you have not received the Spirit that makes you fearful slaves. Instead, you received God's Spirit when he adopted you as his own children. Now we call him Abba, Father. For his Spirit joins with our spirits to affirm that we are God's children. Praise God. There's no orphans in the kingdom of God. None. We all have our Father in heaven. We talk with him, we commune with him, and we can even speak his language. Our spirits can communicate directly with him, renewing our spirits, making sure we're on track. Next slide. To be led by the Holy Spirit means to follow the Holy Spirit. And so we ask ourselves this very, very simple question, who am I following? And who is leading me? Who dictates to us what our value system is? What is important? How do we allocate the 24 hours that we are given per day? Who does that for us? And the bigger question is, who's advising us of the values of life? And I trust it's the Holy Spirit. As we read the Word, as we are Bible-based, as we are Jesus-focused, and as we are Holy Spirit-led. Next slide, please. When you come to a decision and you don't know which way to go, stop. Stop. And simply ask. Because all who are children of God are led by the Spirit of God. And so we don't go down the wrong path. We go the right path. Why? Because we are led by the Holy Spirit. And so we simply surrender our own agendas, our own plans, and we ask God. And it doesn't matter how small the fork in the road is or how big it is, no matter how the decision, see, well, this is just a small decision. If there's hesitancy in any decision, stop right there and ask the Holy Spirit to take the lead again and ask for forgiveness. And I find myself that many times I just simply have to ask for forgiveness by the simple fact that I don't know which way to go. Because if we're led by the Spirit of God, we will just go automatically down the right path. It happens naturally, supernatural living naturally. And when there's a doubt, I have to first of all ask forgiveness for the doubt, because it means I'm therefore not living in tune 100% with the leading of the Holy Spirit. And so I want to encourage us as a congregation is that we are people who are known as being led by the Spirit of God. Being led by the Spirit of God means that we will never contradict what's in Scripture. We are Bible-based. And as we are Bible-based and Jesus-focused and Holy Spirit-led, we will be walking down a pathway which is honorable and pleasing to Him. Amen.